Hello and welcome to number two in the series of three snapcasts looking at colorimetry. Number one was important because there we took a look at the workings of the colorimeter and we looked at Beer's law, or the Beer-Lambert law, which connects absorbance to transmission. Transmission or transmittance is the amount of light getting through the colored sample, while absorbance is the amount of light absorbed by the sample. We learned that through the Beer-Lambert law we can write the equation that the log to the base 10 of 1 over the percentage transmittance turns out to be directly proportional to the concentration of the colored material, where K is a constant or proportionality constant, and that can be written, that indeed is the absorbance. I'm not going to look any more at that. Snapcast 1 is the place to look if you would like to find out more about that. So here we're going to take a look at the use of colorimetry in a method known as continuous variation, or continuous variations, also known as Jobs method. And specifically we're going to use this approach, which can be used for lots of similar experiments, to determine the so-called stoichiometric ratio of copper to ammonia in the reaction where copper two ions react with ammonia solution to form a deep blue colored complex solution containing a copper complex ion known as tetraamine copper two hydroxide. A reaction that in fact you studied in GCSE. You may recall the two-stage reaction where you added ammonia solution dropwise to a dilute blue solution of copper sulfate. In the first step, a light blue precipitate of copper hydroxide formed, and then as you added excess ammonia, that light blue precipitate redissolved and you ended up with a dark blue solution. Well, it's that dark blue solution that we're investigating here. We want to find out the molar ratio in which copper two ions react with ammonia, where ammonia is a ligand. Just a quick view of our old-fashioned colorimeters. Recall the scales, top scale, simple arithmetic scale, in other words where the divisions are equal, and it goes from 0% on the left to 100% transmittance on the right. 100% transmittance would be a sample that's not colored and lets all the light through. And then on the lower scale we have what's known as a logarithmic scale, where as we move from zero on the left to infinity on the right, the divisions get closer and closer together. In fact, if you look, we go from 0 to 1 using up most of the scale, and then we arrive at infinity in this short distance thereafter. So a strange scale. But you recall that the advantage of the absorbance scale is the fact that we get a straight line coming up from the origin. And again, I would advise that you look at Snapcast 1 in the series if you're not fully acquainted with that. Okay, we're going to take a look at a general case, first of all. We're not looking at copper sulfate here. We're just going to refer to two solutions, A and B, which go on to form a product that's coloured, certainly more deeply coloured than either A or B. And this method then is known as Jobs method, or the method of continuous variation. It's a simple approach to the determination of the chemical reaction stoichiometry. How many moles of A react with how many moles of B? And it works, as we've said, where the reactants form a product that is intensely coloured, or at least considerably more coloured than the reactants themselves. How does this Jobs method work? Well, we make up a series of solutions, each containing the same, it's not strictly speaking always the same total number of moles. You'll see that it's always the same total cubic centimetres present, sometimes the same total moles present of reactants A and B. Indeed, in this example we're about to look at, you'll see that it's not the same total moles, but it is the same total volume of the two. And that's sufficient, as you'll see when we reason the mathematics, it will work. In the experiment we're about to look at, the total volume in each case of A and B will be 10 cubic centimetres. but we'll vary it. Let's take a quick glimpse at the next slide and you'll see what I mean. In the first one, we put 10 cubic centimeters, but they're entirely chemical B. In the last one, we put 10 cubic centimeters, but they're entirely chemical A. In all the others, we put 10 cubic centimeters, but different combinations. And this is the principle of continuous variation. The total volume is the same, but the ratio of the volumes of A and B are changing in a gradual, systematic way. Clearly, what's going to happen in this case is, when we react A and B in the so-called stoichiometric ratio, or close to it, that's the darkest solution that we'll get. That's where we get A, the maximum or the most colored product of the samples that we have mixed, and also, importantly, where we have the least amount of excess reactant which would dilute that color. So what's going to happen is these will be this sample here, depending on the color of A and B. This sample will be light in color, this sample will be light, possibly colorless, and somewhere in between, with some of these particular combinations, we're going to get a dark solution. The color of the solution is going to increase to some particular point where we get the stoichiometric ratio, and thereafter it's going to decrease. So it's going to go back down again. So each contains the same, not moles in this case, but the same total number of cubic centimeters, but in different ratios. Now the maximum amount is obtained when the solutions are combined in the stoichiometric ratio, or closest to the stoichiometric ratio. And colorimetry can be used here because the product is much more deeply colored than either of the reactant solutions. Here's an example of what we might get. Here we see solutions that mix. Maybe in this case you see we're increasing the number of moles of reactants from left to right, whereas we're increasing the number of reactant B here. Reactant A has been increased from right to left, which means that this here is entirely reactant A, whereas this is entirely reactant B, let's say. So this is the starting color of B, and A in this case is apparently colorless and clear. As we mix them, we're moving towards the most intensely colored, which in this particular case is here. And this represents the darkest solution. It's not necessarily the stoichiometric ratio, but it's the one closest to it because it's the darkest. What's happening is they're getting darker as we go up to here, and then they're getting lighter in color as we go down here. They're lighter along here because A is in excess, and lighter here because B is in excess. This is the kind of graph we might get. And here we see this is the point of maxima, which happens to be one of the actual mixtures that we made up. Quite often this wouldn't be the case. You might find that your points go up something like so. And what would you do in that instance? You would extrapolate both lines, and where the lines intersect, that would represent the stoichiometric ratio. So you would come down just as we've done here, and you would read off the stoichiometric ratio, which in this case is, in terms of cubic centimeters, is 4 cubic centimeters of A to 6 cubic centimeters of B. Now it is often the case here in exam questions that the two concentrations are not the same. Here the concentration of A is 0.05, whereas B is exactly twice that concentration at 0.1 molar, and we'll have to factor that in. But let's get the cubic centimeters first. You'll agree that we have indeed this, I should explain this scale. You may have come across this double scale before, and I've accounted how moles of A are increasing. This is A on the top and B at the bottom. Moles of A is increasing as we go from left to right. Moles of B is increasing as we go from left to right, and from right to left for B. Now, we also factor in then the fact that concentration of B is twice that of A. So let's see how we do that. And we don't have to go converting cubic centimeters and molar solutions into moles is not necessary. We can simply use mathematical factors to do this, as you'll see now. You'll agree that the ratio in terms of cubic centimeters is 4 of A to 6 of B, and that's what I presented here. That can be simplified, that ratio. If we divide both by two, we get a ratio 2 to 3. So in other words, for every 5 moles that we would have, just that we can relate cubic centimeters to mole, for every 5 cubic centimeters, we have 3 of B and 2 of A. Now, if we factor in the concentrations of these, and the fact that B is twice the concentration, that's what I'm going to do now. So the concentration of B is double that of A, and that, for that reason, that's why I double, in terms of moles, I double the volume in respect of B. Hopefully that's clear enough. So while the cubic centimeters ratio is 2 to 3, the moles ratio is 2 to 6, simply because the concentration of B is twice that of A. And a molar ratio of 2 to 6 is the same as, divide both by 2, is the same as 1 to 3. 1 to 3. So in other words, the stoichiometric ratio of A reacting with B is 1 mole of A to 3 moles of B. Let's see how that can be used now for the one that's on your syllabus, which is this deep blue coloured tetraamine copper 2 complex solution. So we're using colorimetry and we want to find the molar ratio that produces the maximum product. We want to find the solution that would be the combinations of the two chemicals that would produce the deepest colored product solution. We're mixing copper 2 sulfate, which is very dilute, and it will be a very light blue color in that solution. The ammonia solution is completely colorless, and the product of the reaction is this tetraamine copper 2 ion, which is dark blue. The solution appearing darkest in color has the highest concentration of the product, appearing the darkest blue in color. Now, if it's the darkest blue in color, it will absorb the most light. It'll have the highest absorbance. It will allow the least amount of light through. It will therefore have the lowest transmittance. So whether you choose to use percent transmittance or absorbance, it will work with either method. This is what you might get when you make up your solutions. Again, remember, it's the method of continuous variation. You could, again, in this particular case, for example, you could take copper sulfate, which is of concentration 0.05 molar, and ammonia solution, which is 0.1 molar, in other words, twice the concentration of the copper sulfate. Here you see that this would be entirely ammonia, which is a colourless clear liquid, and this here would be entirely the pale coloured solution of copper sulfate. As we react these solutions together in different volumes, but where the total volume is the same, perhaps 10 or 20, then we see that the amount of product formed is increasing because the solution is getting more intensely coloured, a deeper blue. Now, this is not necessarily the stoichiometric ratio, but it's certainly the darkest coloured solution, and of these it contains the most of the tetraamine copper 2 ion. During this stage we have ammonia in excess, and then as it begins to fade in colour again, here we have excess copper sulfate. Let's see then from an actual exam question how we would be expected to interpret data on this. But do bear in mind, this won't always be the case, but typically the concentration of the copper sulfate in these questions is given as half the concentration of the ammonia. So you need to remember to factor that in. And I believe that's the case in this very next question. I'd ask you to pause and have a go at this. Which of these graphs represents the absorbance against volume in a colorimetry experiment for the solutions of copper sulfate and ammonia? And I'm going to have to tell you that the actual stoichiometric ratio of the copper 2 ions, to the ammonia molecules, the ligand, is 1:4. On the basis of that, and factoring in, remember to keep in the fact that these are not the same concentration, the ammonia at 0.1 molar is exactly twice the concentration of the copper sulfate. You see it in terms of absorbance, it's increasing to this point of maxima, where the solution is darkest and absorbs most light. Did you get this answer coming up? The answer was B. And here is an explanation of why. The way to approach such questions is to work out the numbers of moles. Should have been consistent here and just write MOL. Sorry about that. Now, let's work out the number of moles of copper sulfate. And the ratio, it must work out, you recall, ratio of copper 2 ions to ammonia must work out as 1:4. So let's look at what we've got here. 3.3 cubic centimeters, and this is cubic centimeters of 0.05, to 6.6. That's clearly a third to two-thirds, or a 1 to 2 ratio. I hope you can see that. If we divide both by 3.3, divide 3.3 by itself, you get 1. Divide 6.6, and you get 2. So you have, if we look at this, you have the top line is the copper sulfate. Let's look at cubic centimeters first of all. You've got, let me start fresh over here, copper 2 ions to ammonia molecules in solution. You have in terms of cubic centimeters 3.3 of the copper sulfate. We'll factor in the concentrations in a moment. 3.3 cubic centimeters to 6.6. With ratios, we want to get whole numbers, so we divide both by 3.3, and that's the same as 2. Sorry, that's the same as 1 to 2. We now have to factor in that the ammonia is twice the concentration. So, in straightforward terms, we can then say in terms of moles, that's 1 to 4. In other words, because the concentration is double, I have to double the 2 to 4. And that's where the answer is worked out. Here's another question, again about this tetraamine copper 2 ion, which can be presented as shown there. Sorry about the quality of the print here. Pause and have a go at this. The formula of a complex formed by the reaction of copper 2 ions with ammonia was determined by Jobs' method and found to be that. If 3.4 cubic centimeters, that's 3.4 cubic centimeters, of 0.1 molar copper sulfate were used in determination, what volume of ammonia of 0.2 molar ammonia solution would be required? The good thing here is the consistency of the fact that the ammonia solution is twice the concentration of the copper. So I'll pause for a moment and let you have a go at that. Did you get this answer coming up? This is the approach. You have a mole. We know that it should be 1 mole of copper sulfate to 4 moles of ammonia. We are told here that we have 3.4 cubic centimeters of 0.1 molar copper sulfate. Now we know that we would need 4 times as many moles. So I've simply taken this figure on the left and, as you see, multiplied it by 4 here. The problem, however, is that this is not the concentration of the ammonia. The concentration of the ammonia is 0.2. So I had to, what I had to do here was multiply that by 2. And if you want to keep the number the same, then you've got to divide something else by 2. And that's what I did. Again, I repeat that. The problem at this particular line here is that while the statement is correct, we have not been given 0.1 molar ammonia solution. We've been given twice that concentration. And if the concentration is twice and you want the same number of moles, then you'll have to take half as many cubic centimeters, which is where I arrive at 1.7 cubic centimeters. Okay. And 4.4 times 1.7 is 6.8. So that's our answer. Hope you got C. Just some other information on the same topic here about the stoichiometric ratio of copper to ammonia. So we have a question here which tells us that the formula of this was determined by colorimetry. Six solutions were prepared, as you see here. Different combinations of copper 2 and ammonia solutions. You see the color intensities, of the different solutions are compared using a colorimeter, and the results were plotted on the graph which you're going to see now. Again, you see the consistency here. The concentration of the ammonia has been given as twice the concentration of copper, but in your own questions that may come up in a future exam, please do check and do not take it for granted that the ammonia concentration will always be given as twice the concentration of the copper. And here's your typical graph. You see they've put in their readings here for different, this you can see is the volume. It's marked here. The top one is the volume of the ammonia, and the lower one is the concentration of the copper solution. Copper, it's the number of cubic centimeters of copper. So as we go on the top scale, we are increasing the volume of ammonia, and on the bottom scale we're decreasing the volume of copper sulfate. But all we're looking for is the point of maxima, which happens to be one of the combinations used, which you see here is 2:1. So you use the standard setup moles of Cu++ to moles of NH3. That's what you've got to end up with. But you can start with cubic centimeters first of all. So maybe it's just better to say ratio cubic centimeters, and then put your Cu++ to NH3. And you can see that the particular combinations, be careful that you take the values from the correct axis there, or the correct line of the x-axis. Remember that we have ammonia on the top, so we have 2:1, or 1:2 in the way I've written here. And then you bring in the fact that the concentration of the ammonia is twice that. So when you go to ratio moles, it's then 1:4. What is the colour produced in this solution? Pause and have a go at each of these. Explain what's meant by the percentage absorbance on the vertical x-axis, and why does the graph increase to a maximum value? Color, dark blue. Explain what's meant by the percentage absorbance on the vertical axis. Percentage absorbance, and that's not normally given as percentage absorbance, it's percentage transmittance, but just absorbance. It's not a percentage scale as you've seen. So what's meant by absorbance? That is literally the amount of light that is absorbed by the sample as the light is passed through the cuvette. So it's the light absorbed. It's a measure of the light absorbed. Why does the graph increase to a maximum value? Well, we've been through that. Because initially one of the reactants is in excess, and then towards the end the other reactant is in excess, and that's why it approaches to a maximum. So you should try to express that in your own clear terms. But certainly bring in the idea that as you mix the solutions in different combinations, different volumes, but the same total volume in each case, you will in most cases have one or other of the reactants in excess. And since they are lighter in color, and such solutions that haven't got the right stoichiometric ratio will be producing less of the colored product, and will have more of these lighter colored reactants in excess to dilute the color. Calculate the number of moles of copper ions. Well, we've gone through that. We calculated that as 4 moles of the ammonia to 1 mole of the copper 2. So it's 4 molecules to 1 ion, or 4 moles to 1 mole. The formula of the copper amine complex is written, these complexes are always written within square brackets. Now the ammonia molecules are neutral ligands, so they don't affect the charge on the copper, which is 2 plus. So this will have a 2 plus ion. That's the formula of the complex. The compound that's formed actually is that. It's tetraamine, copper 2, hydroxide. Write an equation for the formation of the complex ion. It's a two-stage reaction that the copper sulfate reacts with. Well, you've got to appreciate that ammonia is a complex solution. When you add ammonia to water, 1,000 cubic centimeters of ammonia dissolves in a cubic centimeter of water, so it's highly soluble. All of the ammonia will dissolve. A small percentage of the ammonia molecules will interact with the water, producing ammonium ions, NH4+, and hydroxide ions, OH-. Sometimes when we show ammonia solution reacting, we represent it using NH3 aqueous. Other times, we represent it as NH4OH, and both are correct. It depends on the circumstances, how you're balancing the reaction, how you need to balance the reaction. You're going to see here that I use in one instance, in step one, the ammonium hydroxide, and that gives me a precipitate of copper hydroxide, CuOH twice, a light blue precipitate. We need two in there, and it'll form ammonium sulfate, which is NH4 twice. I can get it in here, SO4. But then that CuOH twice precipitate, when you add excess ammonia, it reacts with the ammonia, 4NH3. And it forms that complex that I showed just above there, which in square brackets is Cu, NH3 four times, and then OH twice. That's your tetraamine copper 2 hydroxide. There may also be water ligands attached on there. If we take a look at the structure of that, if it's an octahedral complex, four of them will be ammonia molecules, for example, NH3 there. These should be have arrows on them because the ammonia is donating the lone pair in that date of covalent bond. So we put another NH3 on here and here. There will be water molecules on here, OH2, like so. And that's the proper formula, I believe. But normally we don't bother putting the waters in there. Here's another completely different area now we're moving into, but at the same time it's based on Job's method. Here's a report from way back, I suppose, in the 1950s. So a development that led to the development of the breathalyzer, and it has saved, I'm sure, hundreds of thousands of lives by encouraging people, drivers, to behave more sensibly. Two Australian chemists have developed a method for measuring the ethanol content of alcoholic drinks, which is based on the oxidation of ethanol by acidified dichromate, potassium dichromate in other words. In this method of analysis, the intensity of the colour of a solution of dichromate, which is orange, to which an alcoholic drink has been added, is compared with that of a solution of dichromate alone. So as you add the alcohol, the orange colour of the solution is going to change. In fact, it changes from orange to green as it goes from one oxidation state of chromium to another. This comparison is being made using a colorimeter. Because solutions of dichromate ions have an intense orange colour, light with a wavelength of 440 nanometers is chosen for use in the colorimeter. The difference in absorbance at this wavelength between the two solutions is measured, in other words, between the pure orange potassium dichromate and the other orange dichromate to which a certain amount of alcohol has been added. Under the conditions used in the analysis, this change in absorbance is directly proportional to the amount in moles of the dichromate ions which have reacted with the alcohol. It's also therefore directly proportional to the amount in moles of ethanol which was added to the alcoholic drink. And this is the whole intention, is to determine the amount of alcohol in an alcoholic drink by a simple inorganic reaction. The diagram below summarizes the wavelength range of colored light, and you remember the mnemonic, Richard of York gained battle in vain. It helps us to remember the colors of the spectrum in the correct order. Using the information in this diagram, explain why light with a wavelength of 440 nanometers, somewhere up in here, is used for measuring the concentration of the orange solution of dichromate ions. What do you think is the answer to that? If you've watched the first Snapcast, hopefully you'll be able to reason something out. So what they do is they pass light through the sample of this particular wavelength, even though the solution itself is orange, somewhere down in here. Here's the answer coming up. Solutions of dichromate ions reflect orange. So whenever light with all the colors of the spectrum, Richard of York gained battle in vain, when light passes through orange potassium dichromate, what it does is it absorbs some of those colors of the spectrum, and then it emits others, and it's the combination of what it emits that appears as orange light. What it actually does do is it absorbs the light up here and reflects the light down here, and a blend of those wavelengths of light comes out as orange. We perceive that as orange light. Now, in Snapcast 1, when we looked at the workings of the colorimeter and the background theory, I described how it is better to filter out the wavelengths of light which simply go in and are unaffected and come out and are transmitted unchanged. If we can filter those out and work only with the wavelengths of light which are likely to be absorbed by the sample, then we get a much bigger deflection on the scale. So that instead of our readings changing from in the range, let's say, from 95 to 90, we get them deflecting much larger on the scale, perhaps from 90 down to 35 or something like that. That's the significance of the spectrometer in a spectrophotometer. The spectrometer selects out light of the appropriate wavelength for the particular color of solution that you're dealing with. So, in straightforward terms then, they absorb blue or blue-violet light. That is the orange orange-colored dichromate solutions absorb blue or blue-violet light, and that's the wavelength of light that really we should be working with solely for the best results. You can see here the answer must make clear that by using this wavelength, the measurement is more accurate. Only the light which is changing in intensity as it goes through the colored sample is being detected. Briefly describe how absorption of light by an atom, molecular ion, can be explained in terms of the effect of the light on the electrons. So we're back here to a topic you studied some months back, and that's atomic theory. Can you recall the answer to this? Pause and have a go. You should have come up with the fact that electrons can only occupy definite energy levels. Of course, within those energy levels, you've got sublevels as well. Energy equal to the difference between the energy levels is transferred to electrons from the light. The energy transferred then is proportional to the frequency of light absorbed. So if we pass light through a particular sample that may cause electrons to jump from one level to another to obtain what's known as an atomic absorption spectrum, then only when we are passed, only the wavelengths of light that correspond to the energy required for those specific jumps will be absorbed. The method used to analyze the contents of a bottle of white wine is given in the following slides. And I'm not going to discuss these with you, but should you be interested, I'll leave them up for long enough for you to pause and read down through them. So here you're taking a specific volume of the dichromate solution. You're then adding a relatively small amount, 50 microliters. A microliter is 1/1,000,000th of a liter, or 1/1,000,000th of a cubic decimeter, or 1/1,000th of a cubic centimeter, so a very small amount. Remember, whenever you have an oxidation reaction, you need acid to help the reaction. And then you're finding the absorbance, and of course you'll need to do it with a blank, and you'll need a calibration graph. You can see then how it's interpreted if you're interested. And here's what the calibration graph might look like. You've got the change in absorbance. The solution you see here, the amount of alcohol added to the solution. So you're putting in here, you're putting increasing amounts of alcohol going from 0 up to 50, 100, 200 microliters. This is moles of the alcohol. And what's happening to the absorbance as you add increasing amounts of alcohol? The absorbance is increasing. Now, this isn't fully explained. You're aware from organic chemistry, if you've ever seen this reaction, you've got a light orange coloured solution and it turns a dark green in colour. So this is why the absorbance in this particular case is not decreasing, it's increasing, because the colour of the solution is going from a relatively light orange colour to a very dark green colour as it changes from one oxidation state to the other. We're beginning to revise your transition metal and redox chemistry here. Describe what measurements you could make in order to plot a calibration graph such as the one shown on the previous slide. Here's the answer. Measure the absorbance of a number of solutions of dichromate solution to which different amounts of ethanol. So this is your continuous variations again. You'd have the same total volume of liquid, presumably, maybe 10 cubic centimetres, but the number of drops or microliters added of alcohol will vary as you go down from one test tube to the next. And what will happen is the more microliters of ethanol you add, the more the colour will change from orange to a relatively dark green colour as the alcohol is oxidised, and in turn the alcohol reduces the orange dichromate. The bottle of wine which was analysed was stated to contain 12% volume of ethanol. The change in absorbance was recorded as 0.45. Well, if you had the calibration graph then and you wanted to test this alcohol to see if it meets what it says on the label, you'd have to take the density into consideration, but you can pause if you wish here and see how the calculation is carried out. This is beyond the scope of what you're likely to be tested on, but it may be of general interest to you. This method of analysis for ethanol concentration uses the same chemistry as that of a breathalyzer. The suspect blows through a tube containing acidified potassium dichromate crystals. They can be absorbed onto something like silica gel. And then as the person blows in through the tube with alcohol on the breath, what's going to happen is we're going to get this color change taking place. If alcohol is present on the breath, the crystals will begin to turn green as we change from this ion of chromium to this ion. We go from this oxidation state, which is +6, to this oxidation state here, which is +3. Here's the half equation for the oxidation of ethanol. You notice it's just with water in it here, but it's oxidized to ethanoic acid. We also get hydrogen ions, and those are the electrons that have been removed You're asked now to complete the equation below for the reduction of dichromate ions. Just as the dichromate ions oxidize the ethanol, they are themselves reduced. Could you write an equation for this? Remember how this goes to the 2CR3+. That should be some help to you. The fact that the oxidation state, how do we work out the oxidation numbers here? The whole sum must be minus 2. Oxygen is minus 2 apart from peroxide. 7 times minus 2 is minus 14. What has to go in here to make the sum correct? The answer is plus 12. There are 2 chromiums, so each is plus 6. These are plus 3. When you change not 1 but 2 chromiums from plus 6 to plus 3, what you're doing is you're gaining 6E minus. How many oxygens do we have in this chromate ion, or dichromate ion I should say? 7. And those are all going to change into water molecules, so we'll have 7 H2Os. For 7 H2Os, how many hydrogen ions do we need? 7 2s are 14. And in terms of electrons, 6 electrons. Did you get that? 14H plus 6E minus and so on. You begin by working with the oxidation numbers of the chromium. That tells you how many electrons there are. Then look at how many oxygens there are, and that tells you how many water molecules will be made. You look at how many hydrogens you have in the water molecules, and that tells you how many hydrogen ions from the acid you'll need. Hence you've balanced it. And then if we combine these two equations, remember how we combine two of these partial equations here? We have to get them to have the same number of electrons first, and the problem is this is 4 electrons and this is 6. But if we multiply this by 3, that will bring that up to 12 electrons. And if we multiply this by 2, it'll bring 2 times 6 it up to 12 electrons. And that's exactly what we do. And then we can combine the equations, and if you do so, this is what you should get. So a little bit of revision of your redox chemistry. So there you are. You've finished 2 snap casts, I hope, and there is a third, and it considers how colorimetry can be used to determine the percentage of iron in aluminium foil. Thank you for listening.